So is that a big deal? Yes. Seeking clarification from a match official at halftime, because he's admitted there, in my view, to having a conversation with Klein.
But Ben, let me say this. The NRL cleared him because, under evidence from Cleary, Cleary said that he actually wasn't speaking to the referee, Klein. He was speaking to James Tamo, his captain, in the vicinity, clearly, of the referee. But the conversation, he said, was with Tamo, which is how he just began that clip.
Yes.
OK. The refs say they didn't hear it, so they put in no complaint. Then there was other conflicting statements about what was said and who said it and where it was directed to. But Ivan there in that... And you're the guy asking the question in that press conference. Ivan there, once he at first denies it, he then says, well, maybe, perhaps, but there was nothing untoward. I was just seeking a clarification. Yeah. So in his own testimony there in the press conference, he admits he was talking to the referee, yet his evidence in there at headquarters is that he didn't talk to the referee, he was only speaking to Tamo. And they've accepted that evidence, but not the press conference evidence.
He gave himself up in the press conference. So he's turned around now and said he wasn't talking to the referee.
Someone should be sacked over this.
That's ridiculous.
Someone should be sacked over this. The commission need to sit down and say to the administration, what the hell is going on there? The inconsistencies, the favouritism, the agendas, the public massaging to show that they're... to try and reveal and illustrate that they're doing a good job in there just highlights how out of their depth they are.
So I'm assuming an investigation like this is run by the Integrity Unit, is that right?
I believe so, yes. Yeah.
Ben, what was it, 3 years ago? Trent Robinson went down to the tunnel at halftime in the Anzac Day game against the Dragons and said to the referee, I think it was Ben Cummins at the time, you're just disrespecting my players because he wouldn't listen to the captains on the field. He then repeated that allegation at the press conference. I believe the referee was disrespecting my players. The NRL fined him $20,000 for fronting the referee, and then they fined him another $20,000 for saying it at the press conference. In 2014, Ricky Stewart was at a press conference and he said it was just a shit effort, and he immediately apologised and said it was a poor effort. They fined him $10,000 for that, for saying that. On the weekend, Steve Kearney says about the stripping rule, if we can't adjudicate on it, piss it off. Shit, piss, right? That's just what we're getting down to, right?
Yep.
One's okay, one's worth 10 grand to the coach. We have a coach saying he's disrespecting the players, 20 grand. He repeats it, another 20 grand. We have another coach who gets down in the tunnel, has a crack at the referee about laying over, about the length of the play, the balls that he's not penalising on. The coach then says he's saying it to his teammate after admitting it to his player, after admitting it in the press conference, and they accept it.
It is bizarre. It is strange. And, you know, once he said that in that press conference, I thought, you're hung, drawn and quartered. You've done it to yourself.
He's admitted it.
He gave it up. So, I mean, if he's then turned around and said that wasn't the way it played out, I mean, he said it there in the heat of the moment when he didn't have time to think about a response, right? That's his instinctive reaction to it.
I have no faith in the NRL administration, and this illustrates why. Because it is policy on the run. And this is what, way back in the beginning, when John Grant came out and thumped his chest and they got Dave Smith in, who I thought was okay, then they bring in Todd. All along, it's about we're going to be proactive rather than reactive. And instead, we sit there and we get dealt crap like this and we're asked to believe it, and it's to the game's detriment. And those fools in there think that they can just sit there and just con us all.
I need you to be the arbiter here because
I want to know. I know, but we
live in this bubble every week, and you know you're not here every week, so you're hearing this and you're thinking, "What?"
Well, it's hard to argue with him, to be honest. It's hard to argue. I'd love to argue with him, but it's hard to argue with him on this one because, you know, as I said, he gave himself up. He gave himself, and once he gave himself up, at the very least, he should have got some form of formal reprimand or a suspended fine. I would have thought he would have got at least that at the very minimum. So to walk away with nothing but a warning, mate, you better just be careful what you say in future. Don't find yourself in that position. It just seems a bit weak, does it not?
This is also a coach who used to work with the referees when he was out of a job and sat on the competition committee.
Still sits on the competition committee.
So you're saying heads should roll. I mean, how far up the chain are you talking here?
Look, you give it to me, I'm going all the way.
Right.
I'm sick of this soft management where every decision is measured against the public reaction to it. If this was a junior coach, we had an incident on the weekend where junior players, A-grade players, got in fights and took on the crowd and all the rest of it, and they've come out and they've talked tough and we're going to put them out they could face lifetime bans. If you're playing an A-grade competition and you're a coach and you fronted the referee, you'd be looking 6-12 months on the sideline.
What message does it send to other coaches now? Is it open slather?
Open slather. Open do slather. What you like. Hey, no, do
it. As
you
long as afterwards you no, say no, no, I no. was talking to my captain.
No, they've read this a different way. They said, because Ivan sailed so close to the line, let this be a warning to the rest of the coaching fraternity.
Ben,